Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Saving Francesca, written by Melina Marchetta and read by Rebecca Macauley. Be sure to visit our website, www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, for Luca, and the St. Mary's Cathedral College boys, and for the girls there too. Chapter 1. This morning, my mother didn't get out of bed. It meant I didn't have to go through one of her daily pep talks, which usually begins with a song that she puts on at 6:45 every morning. It's mostly 70s and 80s retro crap. Anything from I Will Survive to some woman called Kate Bush singing Don't Give Up. When I question her choices, she says they're random. But I know that they are subliminal techniques designed to motivate me into being just like her. But this morning there is no song. There is no advice on how to make friends with the bold and the interesting. No 12-point plan on the best way to make a name for myself in a hostile environment. No motivational messages stuck on my mirror urging me to do something that scares me every day. There's just silence. And for the first time all year, I go to school and my only agenda is to get to 3:15. School is St. Sebastian's in the city. It's a predominantly all-boys school that has opened its doors to girls in Year 11 for the first time ever. My old school, St. Stella's, only goes to Year 10, and most of my friends now go to Pius Senior Collage. But my mother wouldn't allow it, because she says the girls there leave with limited options, and she didn't bring me up to have limitations placed upon me. If you know my mother, you'll sense there's an irony there, based on the fact that she is the queen of the limitation places in my life. My brother Luca is in Year 5 at Sebastian's, so my mother figured it would be convenient for all of us in the long run, and my dad goes along with it because no one in my family has ever pretended that my mother doesn't make all the decisions. There are 30 of us girls at Sebastian's, and I want so much not to do the teenage angst thing. But I have to tell you that I hate the life that, according to my mother, I'm not actually having. It's like this. Girls just don't belong at St. Sebastian's. We belong in schools that were built especially for us, or in co-ed schools. St. Sebastian's pretends it's co-ed by giving us our own toilet. The rest of the place is all male, and I know what you're thinking if you're a girl. What a dream come true, right? 750 boys and 30 girls? But the reality is that it's either like living in a fishbowl or like you don't exist. Then, on top of that, you have to make a whole new group of friends after being in a comfortable little niche for 4 years. At Stella's, you turned up to school, knew exactly what your group's role and profile was, and the day was a blend of all you found comfortable. My mother calls that complacency, but whatever it's called, I miss it like hell. Here at Sebastian's, after a term of being together, the girls haven't really moved on in the sorority department. I don't exactly have friends as much as ex-Stella girls I hang around with who I had barely exchanged a word with over the last 4 years. Justine Kalinski, for example, came to Stella's in Year 8 and never actually seemed to make any friends there. She plays the piano accordion. There's also Siobhan Sullivan, who uses us as a disembarkation point for when one of the guys calls her over. In Year 7, for a term, Siobhan and I were the most hysterical of friends because we were the only ones who wanted to gallop around the playground like horses while the rest of the Stella girls sat around in semicircles being young ladies. Most of our free time was spent making up dance moves to Kylie songs in our bedrooms and performing them in the playground until someone pointed out that we were showing off. My group found me just after that, thank God, and I never really spoke to Siobhan Sullivan again. My friends always told me they wanted to rescue me from Siobhan, and I relished being saved because it meant that people stopped tapping me on the shoulder to point out what I was doing wrong. Tara Fink hangs out with us as well. She was the resident Stella psycho, full of feminist, communist, anythingist rhetoric. And if there is one thing I've noticed around here, it's that Sebastian boys don't like speeches, especially not from us girls. They'd actually be very happy if we never opened our mouths at all. Tara's already been called a lesbian because that's how the Sebastian boys deal with any girl who has an opinion. And because there are only four ex-Stella girls, I assume the rest of us get called the same thing. I could get all politically correct here and say that there's nothing wrong with being called a lesbian, but it all comes down to being labelled something that you're not. Tara Fink thinks she's going to be able to set up a women's movement at the school, but girls run for miles when they see her coming. The girls from St. Perpetua's, another Year 7 to 10 school, make up the bulk of the female students. They don't want to get involved with Tara and her movement because their mothers have taught them to go with the flow, which I personally think is the best advice anyone can get. My mother is a different story. She's a communications lecturer at UTS, and her students think she's the coolest thing around, but they don't have to put up with her outbursts or her inability to let anything go. If it's not an argument with the guy at the bank who pushed in front of us, it'll be questioning the rude tone of some service industry person over the phone. She's complained to personnel at our local supermarket so many times about the service that I'm sure they have photos of my family at the door with instructions to never let us in. Every day I come home from St. Sebastian's and my mother asks me if I've addressed the issue of the toilets or the situation with subject selection or girls' sport or if I've made new friends or if there's a guy there that I'm interested in. And every afternoon I mumble a no, and she looks at me with great disappointment and says, Frankie, what happened to the little girl who sang Dancing Queen at the Year 6 graduation night? I'm not quite sure what wearing a white pants suit and boots belting out an ABBA hit has to do with liberating the girls of St. Sebastian's, but somehow my mother makes the connection. So I come home ready to mumble my no again, ready for the look, the lecture, the unexpected analogies and the disappointment. But she's still in bed. Luca and I wait for my dad at the front door because my mother never stays in bed, even if she has a temperature over 40 degrees. But today the Mia we all know disappears, and she becomes someone with nothing to say. Someone a bit like me. Chapter 2. I wake up to silence. No songs about surviving. No songs about boots meant for walking. And then after a moment, I hear her being sick in the bathroom. For a moment I'm relieved because there is a symptom. I wonder if she could be pregnant. But it's too strange a thought. She's only been at the university for over a year and she worked hard for so long to get the position. Mia would have been careful about jeopardising that. Later, when I get out of bed, my dad is in the kitchen and he looks at me and tries to force a smile. My dad's a builder, and I love that about him. His name is Robert, and my mum calls him Bob the Builder. They've known each other since they were my age, so they're kind of like best friends. He's a bit immature, and I know that some of my mum's friends think she should have outgrown him years ago. Some of his friends joke around that he should never have let her go and get her master's, as if the control was all his. It's what I love about Bob the Builder. He doesn't give a damn what his friends or family say. He doesn't give a damn that his wife has a dozen more degrees than he ever will. He works for himself, refusing to expand because he reckons it will change everything. I think my dad just likes what he does and who he is. Sometimes my mum and her friends ask each other what they'd do if they had another life. My dad's answer is always the same. He'd marry a girl called Mia, and they'd have two kids. Whatever this thing is with Mum, I don't think it's cancer or anything, and it certainly isn't pregnancy, because my dad would probably be ecstatic about that. Today he just looks tired and confused. Is she okay? I ask.
She's just a bit down. Go get Luca out of bed.
I'm not quite sure what just a bit down means. I'm just a lot down and I'm getting out of bed. Did you have a fight or something? They are eternal arguers. She is the queen of hypotheticals and he's the master of not thinking beyond the next moment. She believes that if she doesn't challenge what they stand for, they'll end up like other couples they know.
Take away your job and take away your kids. And who are you, Robert?
She asked once over dinner.
Your husband?
He said in what she calls his droll voice.
Then take away me and who are you? Take away you, the kids, and my job. Is this a trick question? I'm dead, right?
He asked,
what are you if we take away all those things, Mia? Can you be you without all of us?
Luca was looking from one to the other. Must you talk about this in front of the children? I asked.
You think too much and you analyse too much.
He'd tell her.
Everything's fine. The kids are happy, we're happy. Everything's fine.
Mia would do that a lot last year. Analyse stuff to bits, contemplate the meaning of life. My nonno had died suddenly the year before. One minute he was watering his garden, next minute he was dead from an aneurysm.
A piece of me is gone,
she told me once whilst we were bra shopping.
I think we're made up of all these different pieces, and every time someone goes, you're left with less of yourself.
A woman with a big bust had my breasts cupped in her hands at the time, so I wasn't much in the mood for a philosophical discussion and I didn't respond. I do that a lot, even if she asks me a great question. It shits me that she can keep me interested. Most of the time she's right about me and what I'm all about, but once, just once, I'd like to come up with a Francesca theory before her.
Eggs?
My father holds two eggs in his hands and I'm back to reality. I don't eat eggs, nor does Luca, but I don't have the heart to tell him that. Later, Luca and I go into their bedroom to say goodbye. She looks tiny, huddled under the blankets. Sometimes I forget how small she is because she's so vocal. She's kind of like a dynamo who does 1,000 things at once, successfully. This new Mia, I don't know. She looks sick and helpless and, worse still, vulnerable. As we walk out, she stirs, but she doesn't even look at us. I go to school with a sick feeling in my stomach, and I dare not look at my brother's face because I know that I'll see on his what he can see on mine. Tara Fink corners me as soon as I step into homeroom.
Today's the day,
she says, waving over one of the ex-perpetua girls who chooses to ignore her. She tries to grab Siobhan Sullivan as she's walking in.
Are you with us or not?
Siobhan Sullivan doesn't even bother stopping. There's some dropkick on the other side of the room she has to impress. I wouldn't rely on Francesca either, Siobhan says, over her shoulder, with a trace of spite in her voice. I've noticed since the beginning of the year that if she ever has to make reference to me, the comments are snide, and I feel like retaliating. But that would mean I actually care what she thinks. Siobhan's nickname used to be the Slut of St. Stella's, thought up by someone inspired by an alliteration lesson in Year 9. A mean part of me would like to pass that on, except I think everyone here is already working it out for themselves. I sit at my desk and watch Tara organising the ex-perpetua girls.
We're having house meetings this afternoon. It's time to tell them what we think of this place.
What's wrong with it? Eva Rodriguez asks. The ex-perpetua girls tend to follow Eva around like she's their security blanket. She's so effortlessly cool and protective of her lot, and most of the time I wish I was one of them.
The invasion of our personal space,
Tara Fink answers, invading Eva Rodriguez's personal space.
No girls' sport offered, and when we do PE we have to share three toilets to get changed or do it out in the open. Or the fact that you can't use the word oral task or penalised or the number 69 without a guy in your class snickering loudly and grunting. Ring a bell, girls.
The bell rings, thank God.
Or that some of the girls get wolf whistled,
she says, following them to their seats.
And others get called dogs. Or that we actually came to this place because of its drama department, and this year they decide to put on Stalag 17, which has not one female role. Or that some teachers insist on addressing the class as,
"Gentlemen, get to your seats, please."
Mr. Brolin orders. Eva Rodriguez looks at Tara Fink and then at me. Let's just learn to live with it. I nod. Things could be worse. Thomas McKee enters the class and burps into my ear. Thomas McKee is a perfect example of most of the boys in my homeroom. They have nicknames like Booger and Jabba, and they wear those names with pride. Sometimes they attempt a bit of irony. For example, calling a guy who's absolutely clueless Einstein. But other times it's obvious.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.